Well, good morning. Can I welcome everybody to this fourth meeting in this session of the Public Audit Committee. I'll begin by reminding people of the Parliament's rules on social distancing and the need to wear face coverings if you're moving around the room or if you have to leave or enter the room. The first item on our agenda for the committee is to agree to take item three in private. Is that agreed? Thank you. And can I welcome our guests, both those online on computer link and those who join us in the committee room this morning. You're very welcome. We are keen to get your perspective on the financial health of the further education sector and governance arrangements and so on, if you want to address that. Also, especially at this time, how further education colleges have coped with the pandemic and what's been the experience for people, both teaching and as students. And also, we also want to cover some ground looking at college performance. And I guess our reference points are a blog which the Auditor General produced in May of this year, but the other reference point we've got is the more substantive report which came out in 2019, which give a kind of weather check on the state of further education colleges at this stage post-merger and so on. Just to say that you don't have to respond to every single question, and there may be areas that you've got particular enthusiasm to take part in, but there may be other areas that you feel other people are better equipped to come in, and so because of the time constraints, we're going to have to manage that quite tightly. For those of you in the room, if you indicate to me or to the clerks if you want to come in, that's helpful. And if you're on the video link, if you can use the chat room and put an R in the chat room if you want to come in on a particular part of the conversation. And just finally to say that when you speak, your microphone will be automatically switched on, and I want to begin then by asking people to introduce themselves, and I'll start with the MSPs who are here. Sharon.
Hi, I'm Sharon Dowie. I'm MSP for South Scotland.
I'm Willie Coffey. I'm the member for Kilmarnock and Irvine Valley.
Hi, I'm Craig Hoy, and also an MSP for South Scotland.
Colin Beattie, MSP for Midlothian North and Musselburgh.
And could I ask the people who are on video link to introduce themselves, beginning with Shona?
Oh, good morning, everyone. My name is Shona Struthers. I'm the Chief Executive of College of Scotland. We're the representative body for all colleges in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. Audrey.
Morning, everyone. I'm Audrey Cumberford, the principal at Edinburgh College, but I'm also the chair of the College Principals Group.
Thank you. And Gillian.
I'm the Strategic Director for Scrutiny and HM Inspector in Education Scotland, and my remit includes tertiary sector and obviously includes colleges.
Thank you. And the panellists in the room, beginning with the Auditor General.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Stephen Boyle. I'm the Auditor General for Scotland. I work with Audit Scotland, and we oversee the financial performance and the use of public money in Scotland's colleges.
Morning, everybody. I'm Karen Watt. I'm the Chief Executive of the Scottish Funding Council for Further and Higher Education, and we distribute about £2 billion of public investment in colleges and universities every year.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Matt Curley. I'm the President of the National Union of Students in Scotland, and that includes all of the college student associations which make up our membership.
Good morning. My name is David Belsey. I'm an Assistant Secretary at the Educational Institute of Scotland, the EIS, and we're the sole union that's recognised for representing lecturers in the FE sector.
Thank you, and thanks to everybody for being here this morning. I want to kick off our questions with some about the kind of financial health and sustainability of the sector, and Sharon Dowie is going to ask those questions.
Good morning. The Auditor General for Scotland's blog reports that many colleges continue to face significant financial challenges. We've got a strong sense of that from the papers as to what they are, but if we could ask the participants today to start sharing their experiences of these challenges on the ground. Don't know who wants to kick off with that.
Karen.
Thank you very much. You're absolutely right. Colleges are facing a number of financial challenges. Since the Auditor General's blog, however, we have seen a very improved position in terms of the adjusted operating surplus that we now see. So across the college sector, we've now got a surplus for academic year 2021 of about £7.6 million with an improved cash position as well. Now, the reason why I think that's an important starting point for the conversation is there are a number of reasons why that position has started to improve. One is we've been able to put some additional funding into the college sector. So we've invested an extra £70 million. And what would be really interesting is to hear how, from colleges, they've been using that money, because it has been a very important part of how they've been able to get through the pandemic, make sure that students are still experiencing the kind of learning and teaching that they would require, but also that they have been able to play their full role in thinking about the needs of small and medium-sized enterprises. So we're looking at now a more immediately improved situation, not without its challenges, though, for some individual colleges, but by and large, It is a mixture of more funding, more flexibility for colleges, and I would say their own actions to manage their financial position. But it's looking more positive. But there are risks down the road, for example, around the commitments that might be made to longer term financial planning. And I think our review, which we published in June, this year, was looking at the longer term sustainability, which we're I'm very comfortable to pick up with the panel as we go as well. Thank you.
Thank you. I know that both Shona Struthers and Audrey Cumberford want to come in. I'm going to ask Audrey, first of all, if you want to come in, please.
Thanks, Chair. And really just to give some local examples in terms of Edinburgh College on the back of what Karen has just said is really important, is that I'm going to say that in financial terms, certainly at Edinburgh College, and I know other colleges, we have experienced some stability, which sounds a bit odd in the middle of our response to COVID, which certainly wasn't very stable, but certainly in financial terms, we have seen some stability as a college, and that has been directly linked to the COVID consequential additional monies that were put in to support the Young Persons Guarantee and to support the National Training Fund, both of which, as Karen has alluded to, were actually very flexible routes of funding, which was hugely positive for the college. It allowed us to respond very, very quickly to immediate need. So, for example, in my own case, 700 job vacancies within the NHS Lothian area, and we were able to co-design fast-track, i.e. only a few weeks long, fast-track programmes to get people into jobs, guaranteed jobs, having gone through those programmes. So hugely responsive, and actually has allowed us to almost kind of pick up new models and new ways of delivering skills programmes and training programmes, and doing them in different ways from ways that we would normally have done things through our core funding. So that has been hugely welcomed. The challenge, as Cam has said, is that we are literally planning on a year-by-year basis, so we do not know if those funds will continue beyond the short term. And so that's where the lack of stability comes in, is being able to plan a wee bit more strategically. And of course, that has all sorts of implications in terms of the staffing that you need to deliver those programmes is there's uncertainty for staffing and for the staff themselves due to the lack of sight on the kind of long-term nature of that. So the flexibility is really important. And of course, the college has undertaken its own actions, for example, VS, which is impacted on staffing, and also things like renegotiating contracts, as all the things you would expect an organisation to do to try and balance the books. So stable for the moment, but working with the Funding Council, colleges are required to do longer-term financial forecasts based on assumptions, which is really important part of financial planning and is hugely important. And when you look at further out beyond this year, then in my own college, as an example, we are looking at having to save next year savings of around £1.6 million, and thereafter, any kind of cost of living kind of pay rises awarded to staff, so 1% in Edinburgh College would mean we would have to find another £500,000 to pay for that. So the longer term outlook is looking more challenging. So hopefully that can just give you some examples at a college level.
Thank you. I'm going to ask Shona Struthers to come in, and then I'll ask David Belsey from the EIS. Shona.
Thank you. I think what Audrey did was give a sort of local flavour to that. At the sector level, what we've seen this year has been very welcome additional funding, but as already been stated, a lot of this funding was one-off for 1 year. And so what that's done is, although it's allowed stability for this year, what it doesn't allow for is planning strategically long-term, because we don't know if that funding is going to be mainstreamed, if it's just going to be a one-off. And there's some good examples in there. Foundation apprenticeships, for example, we've only got 1 year funding. It's a 2 year programme. So we don't know if there's funding coming for the next year on that. So that means people have to make decisions that might displace other learners, for example. We've had really welcome funding on mental health. But again, we don't know if that will be mainstreamed or if there'll be funding that will continue. So you set up services and you don't know whether or not you can continue with those services. So although the one-off funding this year has been very welcome, and there have been many flexibilities provided with the Funding Council, which I think just shows really good working between the sector and the Funding Council, what it doesn't take away from is that when you look out longer term in the college sector, there's a precarious financial situation there. Thank you.
Shona, just while you're giving evidence on that, could you also address the point that you make in your written submission, which is a wider point, I think, about the importance of multi-year financial settlements to allow planning to take place in the sector?
Yeah, it's a really good point. I mean, I've been in post several years, and I think every year the organisation on behalf of the sector have submitted a draft budget. So it's been a one-year budget. What we really need is a multi-year funding, a sort of programme that allows you to know where you will be this year, next year and the following, at least a three-year programme. We've just not been afforded that. So what that means is that you make lots of short-term decisions, and that can often be not the best financial decision. So I think if there's some way that the sector could be afforded a multi-year funding settlement, it would go a long way to allow the sector to be much more strategic, and I think that's better use for the public purse.
Thank you. I think that's helpful. I'm going to call in now David Belsey from the EIS. David.
Thank you, Chair. I think, first of all, we've been looking at the last accounts that have been published, which are on the SFC website, and that shows a underlying adjusted operating deficit for the whole sector. And whilst College of Scotland and the SFC have both acknowledged that there is one-off monies for 2020/21, they are COVID consequentials. They're not an inherent or underlying part of the FE sector's funding. And it's difficult to for us to accept that there isn't an underlying funding issue for the college sector based on 1 year's extraordinary events and funding streams that have gone on to support that extraordinary year. The feeling in colleges is that some colleges do feel as if they are operating in a very tight financial environment. That's the feeling that the staff, the lecturing staff, have within those colleges. Not all colleges, but a number of them do feel that they do operate in a tight operating environment. And I think in terms of the long term, what we would say is that structurally there is a deficit position. The funding model is deficit if you strip out the one-off fundings for consequentials for this, that and the other. And I think that supports what Shona has just said. We do support a multi-year funding, and I think that's one of the few positives the IS saw out of the SFC's report, phase three report of its review, which supported multi-year funding. And that hopefully will be able to create the conditions for stability in the medium to long term.
Thank you. I'm now going to ask Stephen Boyle, who wants to come in to address this point, and then I'll come to Matt Crilly from the NUS. Steve.
Many thanks, Convener. In my blog, we really touched on, I suppose, the conversation we've had already this morning, that the college sector continues to experience financial challenges, but we'd also recognise the point that Karen makes, that there has been some stability during the current year as a result of some of the additional funding that has been provided to the sector and other measures too, such as the use of furlough to bring some financial stability to the sector. I think as contributors have mentioned this morning, the longer term outlook undoubtedly remains challenging. You know, we've yet to see what impact the end of furlough, the increases in national insurance contributions that will come, whatever uncertainty remains about the inflationary environment that we're in and what impact that will have on both the cost base and future pay awards. The other factor that we would highlight, Convener, I think, is, as you mentioned in our 2019 report, we commented quite a lot about the maintenance obligations of Scotland's colleges, both in terms of life cycle and quite a significant backlog maintenance. Who knows, of course, you know, what COVID will mean, what a digital or hybrid learning environment might mean for Scotland's college estate similarly, but it's just one of the remaining challenges to be addressed. And I think for us, an ongoing enthusiasm to see what the plan from government and the sector is to tackle that maintenance problem and in the wider suite of financial challenges that are undoubtedly still facing the sector.
Thank you very much. Matt, do you want to come in?
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I guess I would like to explore further the kind of implications that this, I guess, insecure funding has on students on the ground. So Shona made the point about the mental health funding that the government provides to Scotland's colleges. And that really does make a massive difference to the lives of students. It means that, you know, there's support for them there if they're struggling with their mental health. It means they may be able to access counselling services if they need it. But as Shona says, the funding for that isn't guaranteed. It isn't certain. It's not secured going into the future. It's currently temporary. And we conducted the largest study into student mental health in Scotland last year. It involved both college and university students. Over 3,000 students took part in the research. And 60% of students, even with the public funding that was going in, had to wait to access support services at their institution. And all of those that had to wait, more than half waited over a month, and a fifth waited over 3 months to access the mental health support services that they needed. And this is in a situation where we conducted this research just pre-pandemic. And since the pandemic, more than half of students are telling us that their mental health has gotten worse, as we would expect. So I guess when we make these, you know, we have these discussions about the funding of the sector, the funding of colleges, really, as we see it, the kind of lack of investment within the college sector means that students have to wait longer to access support services that they need. And the precarity of the funding leads us to question whether those support services are even going to be there in the next couple of years, and we really think they are important.
Thank you. I am conscious of the time, and so I'm going to move to Colin Beattie, and I'll bring Sharon Dowie back in again. But Colin, you've got some questions.
Thank you, Mayor. Before I throw something in here, perhaps I could ask the Auditor-General just to remind me. I seem to recall in past sessions that there is an issue around depreciation with the colleges and the treatment of that depreciation. There was some peculiarity, and I can't quite remember that. I'm hoping the Auditor-General can.
I'll do my best, Mr. Beattie, to recall likewise, actually, but I'm sure that there'll be additional contributors on the call who'll be able to remind us. I think you're right, and I might need to refresh my memory in respect of its interaction with the funding environment and also the its ability to use the arm's length foundations as part of the funding and payment of or meeting the cost of depreciation. What's undoubtedly the case, though, and if I'm able to come back with more detail, I'll happily do that, is that depreciation is a really significant component of the costs of the college sector. There's some analysis both in our 2019 and 2020 paper that kind of outlines that aspect of the cost pressure, but it's also stripped out, I think, as colleagues have mentioned this morning, about to move to what's the adjusted funding position. But it is a factor, and Paul, you're maybe not got enough detail to answer your question this morning, but maybe others can help.
And perhaps just leading on from that, I was going to ask some questions about the updated medium-term financial forecasts from June 2021, and I'm assuming that's where the 7.6 million was extracted from. But there must have been other information came out of that. What significant information came out of the financials, apart from the bare fact that there's a potential surplus there? What else did you take from that?
So I'll pick up a couple of points from that. So what we picked up was, while the overall position in the sector is healthy and strong for this year and the immediate future and this academic year, there are clearly a number of colleges that below the line have got some particular issues that we need to address. So we're working with them very closely. At the close of 1920, I think there were about 8 or 9 colleges that were in some had some deficits. Our projections and what we're now seeing going forward is that that number has reduced. So we have about 5 colleges that we're working very closely with below the surface. I think what we would also pick up from the projections is some colleges have had more exposure to, for example, where they have had more commercial activity or where they have had some international activity. Clearly, through the COVID period, those projections have been affected by their exposure to the kind of pandemic situation that they've found themselves in. There are also, I would say, as the Auditor General has picked up, ongoing issues about how we can project forward for both the life cycle maintenance of particular estates, but also longer term capital requirements. So we're seeing a range of different kind of issues coming out from those projections to point up a few. But as I said, we're due to get revised projections in mid-October, which will again give us a refreshed view of the medium term. I'm very happy to update the committee on our findings on those as well.
I'm sure others will want to come in, but just to expand on what you've been saying, there's reference in the 2019, no, sorry, it was the 2019 block report about reduction in income from ALF and from commercial income. Now that was pre-COVID. I'm presuming that died completely during COVID. In the projections that you've received in the updated medium-term financial forecast, is there any indications of a revival of that source of income?
So our judgment would be that some of the commercial income will still be affected by the ongoing pandemic, and that will ripple through. We have seen some quite significant healthy commercial activity in some particular regional areas. So in the Northeast, for example, we've seen a college there that has generated commercial surplus, which it will be, we understand, thinking about putting into an ALF for the future. but they are unusual. And I think what we are seeing is it's the performance of the colleges around either commercial or additional income is very much dependent on their place within that region, how the regional economy is faring, how other factors are coming into play. So I would say that the likely projections that we get in will see that hasn't quite revived yet, and we'll look to the next kind of 3-year projections to see what the colleges themselves are projecting. But we suspect there will still be a dampening of that kind of activity through the COVID period.
I don't know whether anybody else wants to contribute in this one.
No one's indicating, but I don't know. I mean, mention was made there about the interaction with the business community, and I know Audrey Cumberford was the co-author of a report which addressed the college's relationship to the economy, and in particular spoke about the extent to which more could be done to build up better relationships with the small and medium-sized enterprise sector. So I don't know whether, Audrey, you want to just come in briefly on that point.
Quickly recap on the commercial international income. So again, if I can give an example. So at Edinburgh College, our loss of income in that first year during COVID was circa £3 million. And that was predominantly international and commercial income. Now, going forward, in terms of our forecast, we are being very cautious because it's not like a tap that you can just, you know, turn on quickly in terms of that income immediately coming back. So we're having to be very cautious in terms of forecasts going forward. And as Karen said, don't expect an immediate resurgence of international contracts and other commercial contracts. And just on that latter point, in terms of working more closely with businesses, the best example of that was the Flexible Workforce Development Fund, which again was, the clues in the title, was a flexible fund, and it was used specifically to bring businesses and colleges together so that colleges could give immediate business support to those businesses, whether it was upskilling or reskilling of their staff, or whether it was to support their business process improvements, innovation, close to market innovation, etc., etc. And again, the sector as a whole has absolutely grasped that opportunity and is maximising that fund absolutely to its max. But the evidence would suggest that the demand for that type of support is currently not being met, i.e. we could be doing more. So in my own case in Edinburgh region, which has a fairly buoyant economy, there is way more demand than we can actually provide in terms of the funding that we get to support that. So I think that shows there is some untapped potential and a real opportunity do more. And of course, the last point I would make is it's not simply about the college supporting those businesses. Those businesses in turn are helping us shape and plan the type of curriculum, the type of qualifications and provision that we need to be designing and building into our portfolios to make sure that we are going to continue to meet their needs in terms of workforce skills.
Thank you very much indeed. I don't know whether, Colin, you've got any further questions or that's...
I suppose the only other thing is that the Auditor General's report of 2019 highlighted the question about some colleges having difficulties in financial sustainability. Now, Karen has indicated that there's been improvement in that and that you're working closely with 5 colleges in respect of this. But it's been going on a long time now. I mean, this failure to reach sustainability has been going on for as long as I can remember. Is there any leaving aside the overarching funding issue, is there anything within that that is holding the colleges back from reaching that financial sustainability? What actions should they be taking that they're not taking?
If I were to describe it in this kind of way, the list, if you like, of colleges that face particular difficulties each year changes. So by and large, what we get is a snapshot. Sometimes that can, it's a fairly dynamic situation. Sometimes we can find a deficit emerging because a college is in the middle of a transformation program and it's just taking a little longer to work through. Sometimes, as we've been talking about, there can be a sudden loss of some income, which just because they're all operating within a very tight financial envelope puts them into a deficit position. I would say the one area where we are looking at a list of colleges that has been regularly talking about a deficit position has been in the multi-college region in the Highlands and Islands. And the part of our national review of tertiary education was to make some recommendations about how UHI, as the regional strategic body, could look again at how those colleges in that region were managing themselves and what the future might look like. So they're going through an options appraisal process just now, and we're working very closely with them. So I suspect my answer is a kind of not quite a straightforward one, because then the colleges each year that face these difficulties are slightly different. So it's not as though we have the same colleges appearing every year. But there are some areas where it is clearly a more significant structural set of issues, either about size, scale, funding, curriculum content, which we're working very closely with them on to address. But the critical issue, I think, going forward for future sustainability is dealing with some of the recommendations that we've put to government around multi-year funding settlements, around the continuance of some of these extremely important programmes that enable colleges to fulfil their role in regions, and probably looking again at some of the way we set targets. And I know we may come on to this when we look at performance, but some of the target setting could again be addressed where we have activity targets, which may well not always enable a college to reshape itself in order to deliver what a region, students and businesses in the area may need. So that's a longer term prescription for some of the challenges that we face immediately.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Shona Struthers, then I want to move on because Craig Hoy's got some questions to ask. Shona.
Thank you. I think what Karen alluded to there was just the diversity within the sector. It's not that the colleges are sort of standard units throughout the country. They're very different shapes and sizes, and they're in different regions, and so they're each into different regions, and the small, medium-sized enterprises in those regions, that's the college has got all of those links. So they're quite a different set of institutions that we're dealing with. Interestingly, about 26% of all higher education is also delivered within colleges. So although some people describe them as FE colleges, they're also very active in the HE sector as well in terms of higher education qualifications. And the point I would like to make that I think is really fundamental, and I think we've not quite reached it today, is that there is an inequity of funding for college students. So there was a parliamentary question asked by Mike O'Mara in July of this year, and it was he asked how much per head students were funded in preschool, primary school, secondary school, colleges and universities. And colleges receive on average about £4,000 per head. And it goes up in each category thereafter between schools. I think secondary schools are £8,000, just to give an example. So there is an inequity that a student that goes to college gets invested about half the amount that if that student stayed at school would be invested in. And I think that investment in the college sector, if it were to be levelled up, could address some of the financial implications that we're talking about today. Thank you.
Thank you. That's that's a fascinating insight. Craig, do you want to come in?
Thank you, Convener. We've talked about the need for long-term financial planning and sustainability, and then also I think drawn some comfort from the
a COVID consequential blip, and this, which is obviously an operating surplus for this year. But the Auditor General states in his blog that a significant number of colleges need to increase funding, cut costs, or a combination of both to deliver balanced budgets moving forward. However, we know that non-government funding is reducing. So how feasible is it, therefore, for colleges to generate more funding, particularly as the sector seeks to recover from the COVID-related challenges?
Who wants to go first on that?
Shall I pick that up for a first opener on that? So I think you're clearly right. There's a very a kind of a balancing act that colleges do both every year as they're thinking about their financial position. And I think when we were looking at our national review overall, we were looking at that sense of how can we enable colleges to project forward with confidence with some of the more fundamental underpinnings about resource and finances being clearer, even just to have financial planning assumptions clear for the next 3 years would enable us to work very closely with colleges to make sure that we were planning properly for the kind of provision that's required. There isn't one single answer to the question that you've placed, so it's a mix of things. It has to be around long-term financial planning. It's got to be about enabling colleges to play their role in regions to fulfil the needs of students, working with schools, working with industry and business. And some of the recommendations that we've made through are also about how we think about curriculum planning and provision. So I think there's a kind of a raft of things that would go into that situation. And I think it is, because they're public bodies, this is essentially a kind of how we look at a set of public bodies that have most of their resource tied up in the staff base. So we have around 77% of the costs of a college being absorbed by SoftCop, because it's a face-to-face business. It's a how we handle and teach students. So I think there are a range of issues that you could put into that basket of longer-term sustainability. But I think it starts with longer-term financial planning. I know that's been said before, but it's the heartbeat of how this is going to work in future.
Thank you, David.
Yeah, David, do you want to come in?
Yes. I think the EIS as a trade union looks at things slightly differently. And whilst the Auditor General may have said, if a college is facing financial sustainability issues, that to cut costs or increase funding is the way forward. Clearly, we would not be supporting cutting costs or making staff redundant. It's not something that we would support. As Karen said, colleges are public bodies, and they deliver a public service, and they serve communities. And together, all those communities make up Scotland. And it is a public service. And ultimately, it is for the government to fund. And therefore, we do believe that the government needs to fund FE to a greater extent than it does. Now, I recognise what Audrey was saying earlier on around supporting business. We're not against colleges working with local businesses and supporting their needs going forward. But colleges cannot be driven by local businesses. They should be driven by the students and the students' needs. So there's a balance there. So whilst I'm sure that some additional funding can come in via businesses and indeed the NHS and other public sector employers that also send students and benefit from the training that happens within colleges, whilst that is a potential revenue stream, the fundamental reliance is on the state, on the government. And therefore, I think the funding there has to be in. Ultimately, the public sector, the colleges aren't businesses. They shouldn't be diversifying and looking for their own business streams. They should reflect their core mission, which is to serve the students.
Okay, thank you. That's a very clear point. Craig, you want to follow that up?
Just a quick supplementary to that. In the Auditor General's blog in slide 3, he looks at income by college, and I just wonder, Just compare and contrast two colleges, for example, roughly the same total income, Ayrshire College at 51 million and Glasgow Clyde College at just short of 50 million. Ayrshire College gets 5% of its total income from other income, and Glasgow Clyde gets 10%. Is there any more work that can be done within the sector to engage in knowledge transfer or best practice in how to maximise that other income, obviously given the fact that we are aware that there's significant cost pressures coming through the government funding route?
Who wants to pick that one up? Yes, the Auditor General wishes to pick that up. Excellent. Thank you, Steve.
Thanks, Kabina. I was wondering, actually, it probably feels it's more for Shona to express a view on it, actually, but I think we would support the point that Mr. Hoy makes, actually, if the notion of, you know, that this is a very well-connected sector, and where appropriate, recognising that, I think, as colleagues have mentioned, there'll be undoubtedly regional variations and connections with individual business communities that will afford opportunities to some and not other colleges. But undoubtedly, the principle of learning from one another holds very strong in this sector and one that we'd be very supportive of.
OK, thanks. I'm going to move on to Willie Coffey, because I know that Willie has got a whole suite of questions that he wants to go through. So, yes. Willie, thanks. Over to you.
Thanks very much, convener. Good morning to the panel. I'm hoping to ask for your views on the response to the pandemic in a broader terms and the student experience and so on, so I'll come to Matt. But first, before I forget, convener, I wonder if I could ask a question relating to College Scotland's submission on the potential impact of the Shared Prosperity Fund. It's probably for Shona to respond to if she can, and the concerns about that not matching up to the previous EU funding. Just could you give us a little flavour, Shona, of what your concerns are in that area, please?
Thank you for that question. For us, it's about getting some feedback. I can hear myself. Can you hear me okay? Yeah?
Yep.
So for us, the Shared Prosperity Fund as an alternative is obviously new. And so we've got some concerns that it won't have similar level of funding to what we've previously seen with European funding. So for us, it's about making sure that this new fund can match at least what we used to have under European structural funding, and so therefore that the student doesn't get disadvantaged. So I think it's a watch and see, and just make sure that where we need to, we'll influence to get the best for our students.
Has there been any clarification of that, perhaps, Karen, about what we might be looking at in the near future?
Unclear, to be fair at the minute. The Funding Council has still got European social funds that we are investing. So I think, you know, between 2020 and 2023, we've got about £37 million still that we're distributing. Of course, that goes into specific programmes to support young people into employment, into training and into the skills that they might need. I think the big issue here is, again, will it be a replacement like for like? And at this point in time, while we have some commitments about the broad amounts of money, we've yet to understand how that might be dispersed and who will coordinate and who will lead also. And I guess for colleges, that's, again, just a little ripple of uncertainty into the future spend.
Mm-hmm. OK, thanks very much for that. Just on the broader issue, convener, about response to the pandemic, it would be good to hear probably from Matt to begin with just what the student experience was during the pandemic and continues to be, and particularly with the remote learning and the digital side, did that throw up more gaps in opportunity and access for students and probably lecturers alike there? So could you give us a little flavour, Matt, of what you see, what the experience has been?
Yeah, the experience of students through the last year was an incredibly difficult one. I think particularly in Scotland's colleges, where they deliver so many different practical courses that really required, you know, hands-on learning and being in person, and the pandemic made it really difficult to do that. I think colleges done a good job in catching students up in the end to try and get them to to their qualification, but from a student perspective, it was an incredibly difficult year, and the isolation that comes with it as well. You know, I think all of society has struggled with the isolation that's come from the last year. But students are a demographic of the population that typically struggle more with their mental health at that stage in life. And being a student is often more than just, you know, switching on a laptop and doing some piece of coursework. It is a social experience as well. You get to meet classmates and lecturers, and it's a real time where you build confidence and skills, and that leads you to go out into the world. And this year was particularly challenging. And a striking moment this year, I think, was the realisation of just how many students were in digital poverty, who struggled to access, particularly early on in the pandemic, the laptops, the equipment, the internet that they needed to take part in their studies. The government did make some investment into the sector for the last year, which did help incredibly. It wasn't necessarily enough money, and that colleges were often topping up the investment that the government was making. But we still see digital poverty as an issue that is facing students this year. Students' learning has mostly went back in person, but there's still blended learning in certain circumstances, and there are students that are having to self-isolate and lecturers that are having to self-isolate. So learning in many cases does still take place online. In certain circumstances, and some students are still struggling to get the access to the equipment that they need to take part in their learning.
Mm-hmm. There's probably an issue there, a bigger, wider issue there, Karen, for us to pick up going ahead, and whether that kind of hybrid model will continue, it may well do, and whether we're equipping the students and the lecturers with the right technology to be able to enable them to do so. But I was interested as well in the skills issue. Maybe Audrey and Shona could tell us a wee bit about that. I think, Audrey, you mentioned a really good example where I think Edinburgh had managed to adapt very quickly to refocus and put students into the NHS sector, where there's many vacancies available there. But I'm hearing, like other members, are hearing vacancies throughout a number of sectors, particularly hospitality. And to ask you whether the colleges are adapting fast enough to the changing circumstances brought about probably by a combination of Brexit and COVID to make sure that the students are getting those opportunities that they need. So, Audrey and Shona, could you offer a comment or two about that, please?
So, sorry, can I just interject there and say Gillian hasn't had an opportunity to come in yet, and I know that Education Scotland has done some work on digital poverty and the kind of inequality of access to digital software and so on, the hardware. So I'm going to invite Gillian perhaps first to come in on that, and then if Shona and Audrey want to come in as well, I'll invite them. But Gillian, do you want to come in?
Yes, thanks, Convener. Yes, absolutely. We undertook an overview of remote learning in colleges in March and April of this year. Which was good timing in the sense that we were a year into the response to the pandemic, so we could tell the story of the journey that colleges have been on. And you're absolutely correct that one of the key factors facing colleges, staff and learners alike, was digital poverty in all its forms. And often people think digital poverty means lack of access to a device or lack of access to connectivity. But actually, digital poverty is much, much broader. It can be lack of access to a suitable space in the home to learn, competing resources within the home environment, perhaps to access one single computer or laptop, intermittent access to broadband, rurality, remote locations also have challenges. So even with the investment, the significant investment that was into the sector in terms of disbursement of equipment and the pace at which the college sector responded, we still see, or we still certainly heard from learners and staff alike, the challenges faced by learners who are in digital poverty in all of its forms. So absolutely, that will continue to be a challenge, and colleges will continue to have to address that moving forward if a blended model continues over the course of the duration of the pandemic and perhaps even beyond. However, it's fair to say that we certainly find in our conversations with the sector that colleges collectively had responded at pace with creativity and agility to pivot their curriculum online and to make sure that they provided continuity of learning where that was possible. But I guess the overriding challenge moving forward is the challenges remain in terms of equity and also in terms of outcomes for learners, because I think it's fair to say that blended and online learning does not fully meet the needs of all groups of learners. There are some groups for whom it is still a challenge, and we see that coming through in terms of learner outcomes. So there's still work to be done there in terms of addressing and levelling that playing field. We certainly found that colleges had really put the shoulder to the wheel and worked incredibly hard in a very short space of time to maximise their input and minimise the impact on learners. But I take Matt's point, and we also found that in our work, that mental health and supporting learners in a different way was also challenging for colleges, who again rose to the challenge and moved their services online. And in some ways, in some cases, colleges were describing how their services had reached more learners than previously delivering these services remotely. So lots of positives in there, I think, for the sector, but there are still some underlying challenges, I think it's fair to say, particularly around the learning experience, access to practical activities, abilities to complete programmes in year when specialist technical equipment can't be replicated at home, and the ongoing impact of learners who are unable to complete within year, who have had to come back in subsequent year, deferred learners, as they're known, to complete their programmes, which is an additional headache for colleges when they have a new intake at the same time. So there is still work to be done, and still a challenging set of circumstances for colleges, I would say, in terms of that learning experience.
That's a really helpful contribution, Gillian. Thank you very much for that perspective as well. But just moving ahead to that question that I was asking previously, are the colleges, do we think, geared up for the changes in the economy that are being demanded at the moment? I'm sure, I said, other members around the table must be hearing locally that there are a number of vacancies in a number of sectors, and the question is to whether the colleges are adapting quickly enough to those circumstances. And I think Audrey gave us a good example of adapting very quickly to respond to vacancies in the NHS sector. So I just wanted to ask for a little flavour of how you think that's going around the country.
Who would like to come in on that? Audrey, your name was mentioned, and yeah, Shona's put her hand up. So I'll go. I will, as Shona was quickest to put her hand up, I'll go to Shona first. And Audrey, if you want to come in, you'd be very welcome. Shona.
Oh. Thank you. I mean, what I hear across the sector is just pretty much what Gillian just described there. She picked up a lot of the points I wanted to make. There's just been this pivot into adapting the way we teach our students, the way the staff have changed the way that they teach the students, but also how we interact with industry and to the changes that are there, the movement between sectors where, you know, people are coming out of jobs. But other, so like retail, for example, where other bits of industry are looking for people like the NHS and social care. So we see very much colleges moving quickly in that pace. The one thing I would say, and it goes back to our earlier discussion about financial ability to do that, is that you need capacity within an organisation to switch and change curriculum and to, you know, to get people to come in as students to study these new qualifications. And so if that capacity isn't in the organisations, it makes it very difficult. But I would say that I think during the pandemic, the colleges have absolutely stepped up. The bit about that practical piece of work has been so important. We've tried really hard, you know, being COVID safe. We've sent out to students at home equipment that they can practice on because they couldn't come into college to do it in person. So we've tried really hard and been quite innovative about how we carry the students' education forward in what is a less than perfect situation. And we worked very hard across multi-agencies during last year to minimise the number of deferrals. We had a ministerial-led task force, actually, which many of the people in this group that are giving evidence today were part of. And we worked together to provide all sorts of mitigations to bring what was going to be a really significant number of deferred students right down to a relatively smaller amount that was much more manageable. So that was a disaster averted by working together. Thank you.
Audrey, perhaps.
Thank you. Yeah. I don't know whether, Audrey Cumberford, you've got any additional points that you want to make?
Yeah, but probably just one, actually, is that, and to the kind of specific question, is that there is no question that the situation that we're in at the moment has driven change quite substantially and required a huge amount of innovation and adapting how we would normally do things, and actually in a very, very positive way. So to maybe give you another example, there are clearly sectors under huge pressure. Hospitality, you've mentioned, is one. I had a conversation just on Friday the last week with a chief executive of a local authority about the really deep concerns around social care and the lack of people in social care environments to do the jobs that needed to be done. Now, what that, the result of that actually has opened up some very new, interesting conversations about how we might use, for example, current students who are studying social care related disciplines. Could they be exposed a bit earlier to work in a way that they wouldn't normally be, because they would be doing their studies? So they're doing a mixture of studies and skills development and work-based opportunities. We're also looking at creating, for example, dual qualifications. So you may be qualified to work in the childcare sector, but can very quickly move into where you're needed, and that might be in elderly care homes, as an example. So this is an interesting time, because it is requiring everyone in the system, so not just the colleges, but funding council, local authorities, businesses, NHS, etc., to start to think a wee bit differently. NHS in Edinburgh, their recruitment process would normally take, I think I'm right in saying, about 12 weeks to get somebody on their books. They've now changed that so that it's about 3 to 4 weeks. So they've changed their internal processes to make it easier and quicker to get the people that we're skilling up into those jobs that they need. So this is stuff we can't lose, actually. We need to keep looking for opportunities and how we can adapt and change.
Thank you.
Really encouraging to hear that, convener. Thanks very much for that. If there's a chance near the end, I'll ask another couple of
questions. I'll bring you back in before we finish. But a very directly related question is something which I know that Sharon Dowie wants to ask on the SQA situation.
Yeah, thank you. I've got a couple of questions. So what I'll do is I'll just group them all together and hopefully you'll be able to answer them all at the same time. So with major reform of the SQA and Education Scotland planned, how well do these government agencies currently serve the need of colleges? And there seems to be a perception that they're very school focused. Do you feel you get something of value? Do the bodies really understand the challenges you face? And have they supported the sector to respond flexibly to COVID? And what, if any, changes would you like to see moving forward?
Okay, who from a college perspective or a lecturer perspective or a student perspective would want to pick that up? First of all, I think Audrey wants to come in on that.
That was like exam questions, wasn't it? some big questions. I do think it's fair to say that the current approach and model within SQA is absolutely aligned far more to school provision and how school provision is delivered. And therefore, and that's not the same as colleges, quite clearly. So again, just to give you an example, at Edinburgh College, we use over 27 different awarding bodies to meet the needs that we have. So many of those could be industry bodies that provide standards, etc., etc. We also work and are increasingly working more closely with our university colleagues, who can develop and shape their own provision. And therefore, we're looking to university partners to work with us in designing very specific programmes that we know will meet both student demand and the demand of the economy. And they can then accredit and award those qualifications. So colleges have been quite creative, I think, at looking at other options, and no question will continue to do so. And then the only other point I would add is that in the Cumberford Little report, we spent a fair bit of time in that report looking at the importance of micro-credentials and how those bespoke, bite-sized opportunities can often meet both student need far better and also industry need far better. And I know that's something that the Funding Council have picked up and identified, and we would hugely support the recommendation in the Funding Council report around that. So there is work in progress around micro credentials being led by a couple of colleges, Edinburgh and City, and we would be very, very keen to see that work continue. And obviously the sector as a whole is working very hard to input into Ken Muir's work that he's doing, looking at the SQE as we speak. Thank you.
Thank you. I don't know whether David or Matt, you want to come in on that question? David, yeah.
Yes, I think there have been feelings amongst the lecturing profession that the SQA and Education Scotland are predominantly focused on the school sector, and I think that has caused frustrations in the past. I think that one of the good things from the pandemic is that certainly the SQA created a multi-stakeholder group that worked with a range of stakeholders, including the us, and that helped plan out the qualifications that were being delivered and the way in which they were being assessed during the last year. And that working was welcome, and hopefully one that will move to the future. Now, in terms of the future, clearly the SQA has a sword hanging above its neck, as indeed does the Education Scotland. And I think for the FE sector, there are parts of the SFC's review that talk about quality assurance frameworks and how that may be done in conjunction with the HE sector. And that would be something that we are concerned about. So I think that wherever we go in the future in terms of either overseeing the qualifications or delivering the qualifications or supporting the qualifications, we would like it to be as FE-centric as possible, and for it not to be part of a university sector framework, because universities, as Audrey say, they're degree awarding bodies. They deliver their own qualifications, their own standards, whereas colleges deliver the qualifications delivered by the SQA, but also City and Guilds and a wide range of vocational study qualifications as well. So I think trying to get it more less school focused would be welcome for the FE sector.
Thank you. And I think Shona Struthers wants to come in as well. So, Shona, over to you.
Convener, actually, many of the points have been made, you know, about being very school-focused. So we will work with Professor Muir in his review to make sure that the college sector is understood vis-a-vis SQA, because I think it's been very school-focused. But David's already alluded to the good work that was done with SQA during the year around the assessments for NQs and HNs, etc. I suppose the one thing I would add to that is that we've been working with SQA for many years, looking around the HN Next Generation. So that's a bit of a slow burn that could have been much faster. And just to add to Audrey's point, where Edinburgh College deals with 30 awarding bodies right across the sector, we work with just over 100. So that gives you an idea of the breadth and depth of qualifications and awarding bodies that the sector deals with. Thank you.
Thank you. Don't know whether Sharon, you want to come back on any of that? No, that's fine. Right. Okay, well, look, I want to try and move us on in the final minutes that we've got to look into college performance. And the Auditor General's blog didn't have a deep dive audit style into some of the criteria that I think are important for us to at least have a discussion about this morning, and that is about things like student numbers, about the goals to widen access about completion rates or dropout rates and kind of what's going on there, what's gone on during the pandemic and how you see the challenges beyond the pandemic. So I wonder whether anybody wants to give us a start on their observations about those issues around access, student numbers and so on. Matt Crilly, first of all, I'll bring you in.
Thank you, convener. I'm really, really worried about kind of access. The pandemic has been incredibly difficult for Scotland students, and I know a lot of the kind of discussion today is about the financial health of colleges, but actually the financial health of the students within the colleges has really taken a massive hit over the last year. Our research showed that 12% of Scotland students have used food banks during the pandemic. Nearly half of Scotland students are relying on or have relied on credit cards or other form of credit schemes to get by. And I think this is a real shame, particularly, you know, given the fact that colleges, I think, have a real part to play in equipping us with the skills for the future, the challenges of climate change that we're facing, the upskilling that's going to be needed in society. And colleges need investment to bring students into the door to facilitate that learning. But the students also need investment. The students also need to be well supported so that they can get on in their studies, not just get in the door of their education establishment, but actually be supported when they're there. And the pandemic was incredibly difficult, and the student support system in Scotland just doesn't meet the kind of cost of living for Scotland students. And if I could make another point as well, the funding situation in Scotland's colleges, which we've explored this morning, is obviously challenging. And there was a point made in the Scottish Funding Council's report, which there are many parts of the Scottish Funding Council report which the National Union students liked. But there was a part in page 130 where, you know, it spoke about how they would expect institutions to explore internal efficiency measures, for example, increasing class sizes, reducing the percentage of income spent on staffing, ensuring support staffing arrangements are appropriate to the size of an institution and what it can afford. And in terms of the student experience as part of this, it's not really in our interest or in the interest of education for students to be in larger class sizes, for us to have less staff there to support us when we need help. And I think these are some of the major challenges that Scotland students face in terms of their experience at college. And I think it does require public investment. And on this, I would support what David from EIS said earlier as well.
Thank you. Does anybody else want to comment on that? Karen Watt. Yes, Karen.
Thanks very much, convener. I wonder, would it be helpful for the committee if I just give a couple of performance points in all of this, because while the Auditor General's blog may not have picked up on the performance aspects, we publish performance statistics and reports on an ongoing basis. So just headlines for the committee, just a bit of scene setting. Actually, even through the pandemic, in terms of student activity, we were seeing colleges exceeding their targets. So even through the pandemic, where we had set a target of about 116 full-time equivalent students going through the colleges, they exceeded that. We have also seen colleges reach out into the most disadvantaged communities on an ongoing basis. So that issue of people coming from communities who may not have experienced tertiary education is an ongoing mission for the colleges. So we're seeing, even into the higher education courses, as Shona was talking about, the majority of colleges are doing higher education as well as further education. They're recruiting about a quarter of their students for higher education from the most deprived communities. We're also seeing, as you can imagine, the entrance into universities coming through the college route. So a very important part of the college mission in terms of helping students fulfil their ambitions has been an ongoing part of that contribution to widening access and opportunity over time. I think where it comes to performance in terms of how many students successfully complete their course, Matt is quite right. This isn't just about the number of students that go through the door. This is about how many are successfully going through, how many are completing and falling out of the system, and how many go on to a positive destination. And what we're seeing in terms of positive destinations is that around 95% of the college students who come out with a qualification go on to work, further study, and other schemes. So it is a good, positive set of destinations. In terms of further education performance, in terms of numbers successfully completing their courses, we're looking at about 66% of further education full-time students successfully completing their course. And again, this varies across the college system. I think you'll hear from panelists why some of those figures are that way. Partly it will sometimes be about the nature of the individual student and what they want to do. They may change course, they may switch course, they may choose other options. They may, as part of their course develops, they may find employment and choose other destinations. But I think this is still an area of further work for us to understand what's going on entirely behind all those figures in each of the individual colleges, which is why we work with Education Scotland to look behind some of those performance statistics. And the last point I would just make to committee is, I think some of these targets still need to be revisited. One of the recommendations we make in our national review is that we start looking at a national impact framework rather than look at some of the way we've collected data in the past. Look at where the real impacts might lie and how colleges are meeting a range of different missions. But behind some of these figures, there are different performances across the colleges, which I'm sure Colleges Scotland, Audrey and others will want to talk about. But just for headline facts and figures, that might give the committee an opening gambit.
Thank you. But Karen, what are the trends? What are the trends, for example, on retention? You know, kind of the early retention, then the overall retention rates. Are they going up? Are they plateauing? Are they going down?
They have largely been quite consistent for a number of years. Okay. So we're not seeing big peaks and troughs. It's been a fairly consistent picture across the sector. For further education full-time students, we've actually seen a little bit of an improvement over the last very short while, which is interesting. Even through a COVID period, we're seeing students, it shows the enduring appeal of being in some form of productive learning and the appeal of colleges, that students want to be in a learning environment, even where, as Matt was explaining, it may not be the experience that students might have had in previous years. But I think the question is whether or not that is the level of success that we would want to see, and whether there are specific issues lying behind some of those performance status in some college performance across the piece.
Thank you, and I'll come back to Matt Creel on some of these points shortly. But I know that Gillian Ritchie wanted to come in on these questions, so I'll invite Gillian to speak now.
Thank you, convener. Yes, just to pick up on some of the points that have been made, and particularly by Karen, as you know, our colleagues know, Education Scotland has a team of expert post-16 inspectors who work with all colleges, and we know our colleges well. We work very closely with individual colleges, and we have to provide that support and challenge. So in terms of the data and the trends that you were asking about there, yes, we have seen in recent years, particularly for full-time FE, particularly last year, an improvement in retention rates, so more learners completing their programmes. Correspondingly, however, we see more learners who complete with what we call partial success, so not quite completing the full programme, so not actually passing the qualification or getting over the line, as it were. And that may be a consequence of deferral and the impact of the pandemic. But the bigger trend really around that I think is worth noting by the committee is the 10-year trend in full-time further education is pretty static in terms of outcomes. And within that, there are key elements and key underpinning factors which contribute to that. We ourselves, Education Scotland, published a report in 2015 around the senior phase in Scotland's colleges. So younger learners at SCKF levels 4, 5 and 6 on full-time FE programmes are a particularly challenging group, both in terms of retention and attainment, and that remains the case. The Auditor General in 2019 report mentioned the attainment gap and talked about the trends in terms of the most and least deprived and the gap in attainment there. Recent data would suggest that that has not narrowed. So we do see challenges around deprivation and the impact on attainment. I guess the success story of the pandemic period has been that higher education learners, that their attainment has improved over time. So we actually see more HE learners in the last, certainly in the 2019 data, have attained a programme than did previously. So as I said previously, when I spoke earlier, there are certain groups of learners for whom remote and blended learning has been a challenge. And I would suggest the data also corroborates that full-time FE and younger full-time FE learners, both in terms of engaging them in their learning and also their rates of retention and attainment, remain a challenge for the sector. And my final point would be that the buzzword really around performance for colleges is variability. We see variability within and between colleges. We see variability in attainment in subject areas. We also see variability in attainment at SCQF level. And that is the challenge going forward, is to address that variability in terms of the learner experience and in learner outcomes.
Thanks, Julian. Does anybody else want to come in on this point before I move on to Matt again? Because one of the things which was in the programme for government, I think, was a commitment to looking at a range of substantial reforms to student support. And I guess it's, I want to start with you, Matt, but I'm sure other people will have a view on what that might look like and what some of the consequences of that might be and how important that is. You spoke in your last contribution about the financial precariousness many students find themselves in. So I'll ask Matt to open up, but I'm sure other people might want to comment on that bigger reform programme.
Yeah, thank you, convener. Yeah, it's been an ask of the National Institutes for many years for there to be a reform of the student support system, and there are commitments within the programme for government to look at this reform of the student support system. It does seem to be a couple of the years down the line, so students that are struggling now are probably going to continue to struggle. But we really ask for, you know, student support to be based around a real living wage, so that students actually receive income which allows them to live happy and fulfilled lives and actually engage in their studies. And part of this also is the kind of term time nature of student support in most cases. In a lot of cases, students are kind of lose access to their support come the summer months. So the bursary and the loan payments that you receive often finish come the start of the summer, and you're kind of left to fend for yourself for the summer months. Some students will be entitled to universal credit and will seek access to that. And of course, all students will probably try to be seeking employment during these times as well. But for those who don't manage to find employment or who can't for whatever reason, and in many cases they're kind of left without that student support system as a backup to kind of carry them over the line. It is a fundamental challenge that students faced, and the pandemic, of course, has made it worse. 72% of students are kind of worried about managing financially. This isn't just a kind of small issue confined to a small number of students. This is a large, almost three quarters of students are worried about managing financially through this last year. So there does need to be substantial reforms to the student support system. If we're going to do things like widen access to education, if we're going to support working class students to go on to further education and higher education, half of university degree entrants from SIMD 20 postcodes come via colleges. I think colleges really are the vehicle for widening access to further and higher education.
Thank you. Does anybody else want to come in on the question of student support and what the consequence of that is to the health and performance of the sector? Shona Struthers, I think, wants to come in. Shona.
Yeah, I was one of the members of the student support review, I think it was 2017. And at that point, you know, we talked, it was led by Jane Angadia, and at that point we talked about giving students a sort of a living wage so that they could complete their studies. We also looked at what we might do during the summer months. So I suppose it's slightly disappointing that, you know, years later we're still talking about that. I think Matt's very right in saying that if the student can come to the college and has got a sort of secure financial footing, then they're much more likely to learn and to have better outcomes. And that's a much better investment for the public purse, rather than having students who, you know, can worry about their financial situation and therefore can't focus on their studies and perhaps then don't get their best outcomes. So I would wholly support what's said in the programme for government around an equivalent living wage for the student. Thank you.
But introduce more rapidly, Shona, perhaps, is what you're saying. Does anybody else want to come in on student support? If not, I'll invite any member of the committee, if you've got any final lingering questions that you want to ask of the round table whilst they're here. Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. It's a question for Karen. Karen, it's probably 2 years almost to the day where I asked you this same question in relation to Ayrshire College and the recurring PFI obligation that the college has, about £1.4 million each year hanging around their neck. Is there any possibility of a review of that situation so that Ayrshire could perhaps enter a sort of level playing field with all other colleges, given the particular difficult times that we're in post-COVID and post-Brexit?
So thank you for the question. I think what we do with every single college, and Ayrshire's is no different, is we do run very close to them. And just now, they are managing within the kind of the income that and expenditure that they have to deal with those. I completely get the point that you're making. And some colleges have quite anomalous situations that they deal with. Now, of course, our experience with Ayrshire is they've managed well on a number of fronts. They've had other challenges in terms of cost base rises and other issues, but we're not currently sitting with a request from the college to look at that more substantially. And of course, we will run always close and always look at these issues in the round. So I guess my answer is probably slightly similar to the one that I might have given you 2 years ago, which was we'll work with the college. We think that what is currently within their business plan is manageable. If that changes, of course, we will look at the circumstances again. Every college has got some kind of odd anomaly, either a kind of historic thing that they live with or different kind of relationship with an arm's length ALF or whatever. So it is every college's has got some anomaly in it. But I would give a real assurance that we run very close to Ayrshire College, and if circumstances change, either in our policy or in terms of the college's financial situation, of course we would look at these things in the round.
Okay, thank you for that.
Thank you. Yes, Colin Beattie wants to ask another question. Colin.
Thank you, Vera. I was just going to ask a question. I mean, obviously we're focusing very much here on a digital future and particularly equipping students with the skills and knowledge that they need in this new world that we're entering into. However, I've heard comments from people involved in the digital world that one of the difficulties is that the tutors in colleges and universities are not up to speed with the most advanced technology and the difficulty that they have in keeping up to speed. The result is that students are not always leaving with the skills that they need to get into that particular industry. And I just wondered how the colleges tackle this, how they keep up to date with a sector that's moving at such a speed. And this might be something perhaps that Audrey might be able to give some comment on. Just to give you a rest, Karen.
Yep. Audrey, I can see you jumping at the bit anyway, so I'm going to bring you in on that. And if anybody else wants to comment, then you're more than welcome. But Audrey.
Actually, it's an important point, and I think it reinforces how important it is for curriculum areas and staff to be working directly with industry partners and trying to do that co-delivery. So, for example, in Edinburgh, we work very, very closely with companies like Skyscanner and companies who are into space tech, is that they are actually working with groups of students as we speak, designing, helping to design projects and assessments. So in that sense, both students and staff are being exposed to that kind of state of the art technology. And I think it's fair to say, you know, pivoting, as it was put, into kind of remote learning, and they're therefore using technology because we had to use technology, has hugely accelerated the skill levels and our digital infrastructure and equipment in a way that actually would not have happened had COVID not come along. So, and again, this is one of those examples of where we need to keep that momentum going in terms of upskilling and reskilling our own staff in terms of digital skills as well as the students. So a really important point.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to ask Craig Hoy's got a final question to ask as well. So, Craig.
Thanks, Kevin. It's just something that we haven't really touched on, which is just the state of the college estate. I think the 2019 report identified quite significant capital expenditure challenges in relation to that. I suppose just two related questions. One is in relation to COVID and digital learning. Does that mean that moving forward, we may see a shift in the landscape of the college estate as more learning goes digital, if that indeed is what is happening? But also in relation to the significant backlog of some major capital investment that was required into the college estate. We see right around the country at the moment that the cost of materials has surged. So does that mean that a problem that existed pre-COVID could be a more significant problem in relation to the capital investment challenge after COVID?
Who wants to come in on that? Yes, Karen Watt. Karen.
Should I pick that up initially, and others may want to comment? There is I think the 2017 college sector estate condition surveys that we looked at that time are now absolutely overdue a revamp. So what we are doing now in this calendar year is developing a new and refreshed college estate strategy for the medium term. And that's important because this is not only a kind of dynamic situation. Every campus will have shifted and changed in terms of its ability to look at priority work, which we have funded over the last 3 years, but ongoing life cycle maintenance work. But to your point, it's also about how do we think again about the infrastructure that we need and the capital investments, not just in the physical estate, but also in the nature of learning, teaching, how students' expectations have shifted around the digital environment. So it's a really good opportunity now to look at all of that again. We have been able to fund very high priority capital investment in the college estate, but I think it's time now to look again at that. So we will, and very happy to update the committee as that strategy develops with the sector and in consultation over the next short period. So there'll be a revamped estate strategy which takes on board not just the digital challenge, but the net zero and the climate emergency challenge that we've got, to look in the round at what's required, both regionally and in collaboration in some areas where it's not just the college estate, but in some of our more imaginative campus developments where we have had significant funds. For example, I'm thinking about the Dunfermline Learning Campus, where we've got two schools, a college, a local authority, some business partners, all working together to look at that space, for students, for industry, and for the college's future. So a new strategy will be coming through.
Thank you. I know that Shona Struthers wanted to come in on this question as well. So, Shona, over to you.
Thank you. It just really reinforces what Karen was saying. We're looking at not just no longer at bricks and mortar for our estates. We're looking at the digital need and net zero. And one of the things that we're looking to develop with the Funding Council and the whole sector is just an open and transparent criteria for our estates investment, whereas in the past it might have been a little bit vague as to, you know, which development happened, and it sometimes came as a surprise to some people which campuses were developed or so on. We'd just like to make that a little bit more open and transparent with the criteria that we work against. So thanks for that.
Thank you. Well, that brings an end to our session this morning, and I want to thank very much all of the witnesses, both those who are in the committee room with us and those who joined us by video link. The quality of evidence you've given us has been outstanding, so I want to place on record my thanks for the time that you've given and the thought that you've put into the evidence that you've presented to us. It really is appreciated. So I would now like to draw to an end the public part of this morning's committee and move into private session, and once again thank the witnesses for your evidence this morning. Thank you.